Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy, in all his glory. I am joined this week by the merchandise, the current W3L heavyweight champion at time of recording, although if COVID continues, we'll be champion forevermore, Mike Musso himself. How you doing?
Yeah, if I knew you were going with that introduction, I'd have put the belt in the background. It's in the fridge or something, I think. But yeah, thanks very much for having me on, Billy.
That's where belts stay, though, isn't it? I mean, mine are behind me, but I never earned any of them. I just won them off eBay. So this is kind of an impromptu podcast. You put out the call, you want to speak about W3L, which we will. We'll definitely speak about that. But as someone who's been around for quite a while, I've got your debut down here, according to Cage
Too
Match.
Too long, some would say.
Yeah, I've got your Cage Match profile saying 2005 was your debut. Is that, that'd be right?
No.
Yeah,
no,
I think that was wrong.
I think, is that the German website?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they've got me mixed with somebody else and they've literally combined our two career profiles. But I had my first match in 2001.
Yeah, they have a lot of that. I've seen, I think it's Blue Thunder up in WrestleZone. He is also the Bulgarian Baker. He could be, I don't know. I mean, he could be the Bulgarian Baker for all I know.
I've never seen his mask, so... Yeah.
Never seen them in the same place at the same time, so who knows. Right, so 2001 then, so that was 19 years ago. Don't want to make you feel older. 19 years ago, how did you get your start? We'll start right back to the beginning. How did you get into pro wrestling?
It was very different 19 years ago than it is now. Completely different, in some ways better, and in some ways I personally think worse. But it's like everything, I suppose. There's plus points and minus points. There wasn't any training schools 19 years ago. As well as that, you know, I had my first match 19 years ago, but that doesn't mean to say I've got 19 full years of experience. There wasn't the same sort of training process as there is now. See, I started out by literally turning up to events and asking, I want to wrestle, I want to be trained, how can I do this? And it was a Brian Dixon show at the Edinburgh Playhouse. And Brian said, if I stay and help with the ring, then he'll get one of the boys to train me. And Judo John Brown, a referee, wrestler from the sort of World of Sport era, was in the ring training another guy quite a bit older than me. I think the guy was in his 30s and he was being trained. And me and my friend Ian, who went on to wrestle with Spike Anderson and still wrestles in Canada now, we helped set up and then we got in the ring and started training. And that was in February. And in May, we were in a tag team match. You were thrown in there and you learned on the job. When I say that, I think that kind of makes me sound older than I am, because the business in the early 2000s was not a sort of regular kind of gig that it might have been when ITV's original World of Sport days, when the guys were wrestling, you know, nine times a week, twice on Sunday sort of thing, and sold out town halls all around the country. But the sort of the bones of that system was still there. So yeah, that's how I started out.
Certainly a bit different again from your Cage Match profile. It says you're trained by Dan the Beast Severn.
Yeah. I did do a training seminar with Dan the Beast Severn.
That counts.
So yeah, if anything, that's how I started out training, and then I met Jake the Snake Roberts at the Caird Hall. He was setting up a training school down in Aldershot. We went down there and started training with him, as well as going. This is the thing. Now you get emails saying where's the training school? Oh, that's too far away from me, because it's, you know, like you have to take two buses or something like that. With There's two Jakes, just to confuse matters. That time that I met Brian the first time is actually the last time I've ever had a one-on-one conversation with him. Brian stopped touring up in Scotland, and a promoter called Jake Hawkins, who wrestled as Klondike Jake, took over a lot of those venues. And what he would do is they would come up here for like 14 days, and me as a 15-year-old boy wanting to learn, and that I'd been invited along, and it was a lot of the same crew, so I managed to keep this sort of arrangement that if I came on, helped set up, I'd get a bit of training, and ended up in that match. So that match wasn't for All-Star, that was for a company called Midlands Wrestling Promotions, which was ran by Klondike Jake. So that's Jake 1. Jake 2 was working, was the more famous from sort of American wrestling, Jake the Snake Roberts. He was on one of the shows, and me and Ian were tasked with seeing him into the building, checking he was all right, basically being his sort of running boys for the night. And we went down there. I've had a long day, Billy. What was the question? Who? Dan Severn training? Yes. So no, Jake Roberts was the first person that was like a regular trainer. And for that, we had to go down to London. So every 2 weeks, we would get an overnight coach from Dunfermline or Edinburgh down to London, and then get the train from London to St Albans. We used to sleep at the in the ring on the Saturday night, and we'd wake up the next morning, everybody would come back for the next day of training. Eventually Jake let us stay at the house that he was staying at, and then I spent a bit of time in Canada training after that. So yeah, I had quite a bit of different sort of mix and match of training experiences, and when I came back from Canada I was still training and learned from a lot of I seeked out a lot of sort of veteran British wrestlers to learn from and work with, and you know, you never stop learning in wrestling. But that was a much different path to people that started at a training school now, and will kind of see that through and keep training until they're ready to debut. It was just a different system.
Yeah, it's definitely nowadays. It's more like you got your pick of schools. Every school is pretty much within, I don't know, 2-3 hours of travel, I would say, just about. Even up as far as me, which is Elgin, I've probably got school about an hour and a half one way, 3 hours of a train the other way. I've got an upcoming one, which will already be out by the time that this podcast goes out, with Bradley Poole, who lives in Elgin and he trains down in Airdrie. So he's got a 3-hour car journey every Sunday, or had, of course, because there's no training on really at the moment. But yeah, so it's definitely a more streamlined system nowadays. Definitely by the sounds of it.
System, conveyor belt, whichever term you want whichever term you want to use.
So different world. So again, according to my research, which has gone poorly so far, W3L began in 2003. So were you the original founder for W3L?
Yes.
Or was it? So you went
that's correct.
So you went from training in 2001 to promoting your own shows in 2003. So what made you decide to start your own promotion?
Well, it was one show. And I was obviously a young boy with very little experience, but having these sort of amazing kind of life opportunities, and was far too big for my boots at the time. But I got it into my head that before I went to Canada, I think I moved to Canada in the October of that year, and before I moved, I wanted to wrestle in my hometown. I'd missed that opportunity because of a family holiday. My parents had booked us to go on a family, this would have probably been 2001 or 2002 more likely, had booked a family holiday to Turkey, and I wanted to stay at home and not go to it because I was going to miss the wrestling tour, and they were going to be in Dalgety Bay, which was where I grew up. And I didn't want to go on the holiday, but I was 16 or whatever at the time, and I was made to go. I'd have much preferred to wrestle. Because those tours only happen 3 or 4 times a year. So I think I kind of had it in my head that I wanted to run this show locally before I went. I don't think there was a sort of idea that it would take over my life the way it has now. Also, it was totally different. It was this idea of running a promotion more from a fan's perspective, like as an indie promotion rather than live professional wrestling. A more generic kind of style that was being promoted at the time. There was a lot of tribute shows going on, which did phenomenal business. Like, people kind of mocked them at the time, yet they were drawing like 500 people. There was clearly a market for that there. It's kind of ironic that I thought that those sort of shows that I was involved with were sort of uncool in some way, because they featured like people pretending to be Kane or The Undertaker or what have you. And these were experienced guys. They knew what they were doing, and they were doing that to make money because it was working. It was what the people wanted. And it's kind of ironic that me wanting to run a show and run it as like a not a American style wrestling comes to, but I wanted to run it as this is W3L, we're our own thing, our own brand. And then over time, W3L's become, out of all the promotions, probably the most I don't want to put us down and use the term generic, but from an advertising point of view, we're probably the most focused on American wrestling. Come and see, the show, and not getting too bogged down in promotion XYZ, selling on wrestling, the wrestling experience, rather than getting into the weeds with trying to be our own brand and our own, you know, our own things that people won't necessarily understand because we're not on television every week.
So from that timeline then, you ran that show when you were 18?
17, I think.
17. So that's quite an undertaking for anyone, especially...
I had no business running it. It was just something that I wanted to do before. And when I came back from Canada, everything had stopped. Those tours that I'd started out on weren't happening anymore. There was no wrestling in the east of Scotland that I was aware of. I then found out about the group in Dundee that were running. But there was certainly nothing in my area of Scotland. So that's, yeah, there was Glasgow and there was us.
Sometimes it still kind of feels like that. In times you've got your central belt and then you've got kind of companies dotted about the rest of the country. So 2003, so that's 17 years of just shows after shows. You do your tours, of course, which is how I've watched W3L. So that's 17 years. What highlights, I mean, that's a huge, big, vague question, but have you had any particular highlights, either in your own in-ring career or just for milestones that the company reached?
From a W3L point of view, I'm very proud of what we've got, especially when we step back and look at it. And I know I'm going to talk about the video archive and some of the things that we're doing with that later on while we continue talking. But the guys that have come from W3L, your Nathan Reynolds, your Ewan Mackey, you know, some of which you've had on your podcast recently, Billy, you were telling me. I'm very proud that everybody that's had involvement from us, and not all of them started out, but the ones that have really spent time with me, and I've kind of helped with them from find who they are in wrestling and find what they're best at. Everybody's got their own personality that's come from us. Everybody does something completely different and adds something completely different to a W3L show. Not all are still currently wrestling. Guys like El Technico, even Danny Boy Rogers, they're both very talented. You'd almost think that they were the same person. Nathan, you know, has said Kevin Williams, Taylor Bryden, they're really, like, they're all so unique, and I'm proud of all of them. Luke Aldridge, so many different characters and personalities, so that's something I'm very proud of. I'm proud of the sheer amount of events we've managed to produce. Somewhere over 250 events at the last count. The sort of bigger halls, you've got your favorite kind of halls like in Musselburgh and Glenrothes. It's always nice, the tours. I've worked very hard to find out how to promote, how to let people know at a street level that we're coming to town, and how to bring the families in and how to keep them coming back. And with that skill, I've been able to travel, whether it's up north to your neck of the woods or down south. We've run, we've sold hundreds of tickets to venues in England. I'm proud of what we've done as a team. Personally, obviously, I've got favourite moments with guys that I've wrestled, experienced guys, stepping in, like in more recent years, with guys like Joey Legend, who is a phenomenal performer, veteran performers such as Blondie Barrett, who's pretty much the first person that ever helped me out in wrestling and sort of took the time to really kind of sit beside me and help me, and to wrestle him at various points in my career, to the point now where the man's 60 odd and still going. It's always nice. He's kind of been the one constant. Your other veteran guys like Ricky Knight and Johnny Kidd, getting to work with so many different people. My experience with WWE, there's loads of kind of milestone moments that I've been lucky enough to experience. And then that's not even to go into all this kind of fun times sort of away from the ring, in the kind of social environment that occasionally I'll dip into, but more so if we're on a tour or whatnot, and I've got no choice but to let my hair down and enjoy myself instead of go home and continue working on the next project that we've got underway. But yeah, it's been an adventure.
So you brought up WWE. I'm not aware of. So is this a tryout? Did you have a tryout to, at some point?
3 days. Obviously it was, it was a good learning experience. I was led to believe that there was a potential to have more opportunities following that. Nothing's come of it. I'm not getting any younger. There's maybe the doors open ajar. I don't know. Obviously, I'd love to do more with them, but just having got there and had that experience is something. For the amount of people that set out to do what we do, to get to that stage is pretty special in itself. But yeah.
So did you find that 3 days helped with, like, how, because you've got the Action Academy as well, W3L Action Academy. So did you find that time at that tryout that helped you teach others as well as, obviously,
lots of drills and stuff is the kind of things that they were doing at the time, but also little technique things, getting to learn from guys like Jerry Briscoe. Just little tiny things that you would maybe never think about as a fan, or even as a wrestler, until somebody with so much coaching experience points it out. I've had loads of opportunities when I look back at it. There's always that frustration of not sitting here with national television or international television exposure like some people have, and a nice big fat contract, but when you look back on it and think how far you have come, I've got to be proud and think I'm lucky to have done what I've done.
Well, you have had TV exposure. I haven't written it down, but it's popped into my head when we were speaking. Of course, you and the very good Mr. Ewan G. Mackey appeared on Judd Rinder. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how Judd Rinder works. So, I mean, I'm assuming it's
saying it works? Wait, I didn't say work.
I'm just saying, I don't think it's 100% legit. But so that was definitely, you're not the only wrestling company, even in Scotland, that have used, have been on Judd Rinder and had their hopefully their squabble's settled.
Not just Judge Rinder. There's been a few documentaries that we've been involved with. You'll see the logos on the posters because, you know, our brand name's been on it. So it's as seen on, you know, we've been featured on these documentaries or programs on these various different channels. Judge Rinder, what I will say is, in terms of legitimacy, they needed to check that that case was legitimate. And there was legitimately a complaint. There was legitimately action that I had to take. And then 4 years later, I decided that we should take it to court, as you do. But they did have a stringent process to make sure that somebody can't sit there and say that's not real, because they've got the documents to back it up that it is. So, like everything, the lines are blurred sometimes. But we went all around the country after that, and the local newspapers had on their front page often, Judge Rinder courtroom battle ends in wrestling ring. It was me versus you. And considering the point of wrestling is to sell tickets and give people a reason to have their bum in a seat, I'm pleased with us doing that. I know it got criticised in some circles, but everything does. To me, it was job done.
Exactly. Well, I was bringing that up because it was to your point of advertising, how you're advertising, pretty much you're quite hands-on. Even doing the postering, I think your last W3L tour up north, up in Elgin, I actually saw you doing the postering yourself. I didn't interrupt you because I thought, I'm not going to just go up and go, "Hi, Mike, what's happening?" So I actually saw you literally doing the posters yourself. So it's very much a hands-on experience you have. You're not just sending folk willy-nilly, just going, right, you're going up to, I was going to say Strathpeffer, but that's not where you run. Where's it further in Elgin? Dingwall. Yeah. That you go up to Dingwall and go, right, two trainees up to Dingwall, you go. It's yourself that you're the face of the company.
The best way to do it, I find, is to have somebody in the car with me, or ideally, if three people can come, then that's the best, because you can have two people on one side and two people on another side. The worst is three, because you end up uneven. You end up with like a full street done and one person's only halfway done another street. But I do like to be hands-on. I like to be there, and that's probably an OCD thing, but also because if you think about it, I said earlier we've done 250 live events. Now, say on average I've spent even 2 days, a lot of the times it's more than that, I've spent, say, 2 days out there on the field promoting each event. That means I've spent over a full year of my life putting up posters, which is both depressing and impressive in equal measures. So believe it or not, there is actually techniques. You know, I know I look at a town and I know the best ways of getting it done, the places we want to prioritise. It's a skill. I've turned postering into an art form.
Speaking of like the family friendly, I think you are, in my opinion anyway, of the shows that I've watched and seen, you're probably one of a very small handful of companies that are just family entertainment. You can basically take anyone, take kids, take anyone, and they're going to enjoy the show, or at least find something to enjoy, whether it's a character or a moment, a match, or thankfully you've stopped in inflatable hammers, because I hated the inflatable hammers so much, but they were perfect for what they needed to do, which was to
they're still there. They maybe just weren't selling them last time.
I think you stopped selling them in Elgin. I don't know whether I've just somehow just blocked them out of my memory, but yeah, just you I think it's because have. The kids, I think you might have stopped in Elgin mainly because all the kids in Elgin kept using the claw side. And I kept seeing them doing it. I'm thinking, oh God, this is awful to watch. Funny, but awful to watch, because that just looks horrible to take.
Have you actually ever seen the hammer match? Have we ever done one of them in Elgin?
I haven't seen a Hammer match, but I was watching the one when you came up 2012, the first one I saw, and it was Taylor Bryden and CJ Hunter, which was a match I forgot, but when I rewatched it, it was incredible. And it was pretty much Hunter put Bryden out of the ring right at the start, and all you could see was hammers, and he was just leathered with it.
We cottoned on to this, I thought, well, the kids are all doing this. Let's make a thing of it. So it's kind of like a lumberjack match, and one of the villains will come out and be interacting with the crowd, and they'll grab one of the kids' hammers, and they'll burst the hammer, and I'll come out and I'll say, "How dare you do that? Let's make sure this kid gets a new hammer." I'm challenging you to a match later on tonight. And I tell you what, every time you get thrown out this ring, all these kids can hit you with those hammers as many times as you like. And as soon as we've set that match up, there's a massive line at that sales table for people buying hammers. So if the crowd is low, and because at the end of the day, if we lose money, we can't come back because we'd be out of business. So that's been a trick. We've not had to employ it for a while, but if times are tough, then we'll be like, "Oh, look at the crowd. There's not many out there. Are we going to need to do the hammer match tonight? Make some extra sales of hammers." But the kids love it.
I was going to say, I think it's just my age showing that me just going, "Oh, I hate these hammers." But last time I went,
annoying.
Yeah, last time I came, it was I took. It's becoming a family affair, these shows, because my cousins. I live in Elgin as well, and my dad will just go, "Right, I'll take the kids," because he loves Ewan G. Mackey. He's his favourite. So he'll come to see Ewan, and he'll take
my little boy calls Ewan the duck wrestler. The mask.
Oh, right, okay. I was wondering, I thought it was like a stance thing. But yeah, so and the first thing that my cousins want, they're like 5 and 11, something like that, was like, "Oh, I want to buy a hammer." It's like, I get it. I just don't like it. So it's just it makes sense. Speaking of the tours up here, there's always one character that I enjoy. And unfortunately, I think last time I saw him, you were putting him through a table. And that was the Bulgarian Baker. So what's it like getting...
Was that last time?
I think it was last time.
It might have been.
No, it wasn't. It was you and the Baker last time. It was you versus Chris Craig Stevens last time. Time before that, you put him through a table. And what's it? I mean, you speak about making money and using the hammers, what have you. But you've got to pay for that flight from Bulgaria once a year.
Well, that's what we save the hammer money up for. that actually pays for the baker's flights.
Oh, now I'm stuck in a hard place. Then I love the Baker. Hate the hammers. So this is why we're actually speaking. 17 years, you've got this big, you've got 250 shows. I'm assuming the majority of them were recorded in some way because they're used in Wrestling Showdown on the W3L network. So what made you decide to start pulling that archive and put it on to a streaming service, the W3L box office?
Well, we've got hours and hours of footage, and there's literally so much on there. The people that have passed through, like, let's just talk about some of the sort of bigger stars. We've got Paige back when she was, I think, 15, 16 as Brittany Knight. We have got obviously Drew Galloway. Moving on from there, you know, you've got your like Finn Balor at Clash of the Titans. You've got Damien O'Connor. I always forget what he...
Killian Dane.
Yes. Former W3L champion. You know, a lot of the NXT UK guys are in our video archive. You've got your Colt Cabanas, your Joe Legends, you've got your British wrestling veterans. I've probably missed out some of the sort of ones connected to American wrestling. There must be
Nikki Cross.
There we go. Yep. We were looking at doing a little promo video for it, and they were all featured in that. So I should have remembered Nikki. But she seems to be doing really well now, which is great to see. You've got Nikki Cross as well. And then you've got your British wrestling veterans, everybody from Drew McDonald to Ricky Knight, your Blondie Barrett, your Johnny Kidd. I must be missing people. There must be others in there. Soraya Knight.
Did Johnny Saint wrestler? I might think of somewhere else. Johnny Saint.
No, we didn't have Johnny Saint. I believe he was maybe he maybe wrestled a match for one of the promotions you've said that we shouldn't discuss.
Right. So, okay. I think
that narrows it down a little bit.
I don't think it was on my list, but I'm thinking I know which one it is. So that's fine. I think I know which one it is. Yeah.
But there's so much on it. So whilst we do, we focus on family entertainment, and looking through the archive, you can kind of see us change to that. We used to actually be really storyline based. I thought I was booking like weekly television out of these social clubs. And even when we further on to that, when I started to get my sort of bearings of right, what works, what doesn't, I kind of really had to detach myself from being a fan, because I realized that most of our fans were kids and parents. And we sort of started morphing into more of a, here's a night at the wrestling, and we try and tie it all together via wrestling showdown. So there is stories, there is characters that are obviously reoccurring rivalries, but they're much more looser, so they're easy. So anybody can come off the street and sit down and watch a W3L show and enjoy it and not have to have followed it to enjoy it. But by the same token, if you are a wrestling fan, there's going to be people on there that you're maybe familiar with, different styles, like wrestling's a variety show. So we will have some, you know, high flying guys, you've got some big power guys, various different styles thrown in on there. So just because we brand ourselves as a family wrestling promotion, because that's, to be honest, just the sensible thing to do if you want to be a touring group, that the niche group, the niche audience, I just don't think there's any more room in the market for that. There's some people that have that niche audience and that they do very, very well at it, but I don't think everybody can try and get that niche audience. You have to broaden your horizons a little bit, in my opinion. But yeah, there's something for everybody on those archives. We've got I've got two big hard drives with lots of digital content in it, and obviously there was the time that you would use like mini DV cameras before it just went straight onto a memory card. You put these little tapes in the camera and record it, and that's why, just purely because I've been doing a lot of work with this recently, so it's sitting beside my desk here. This big folder contains just pages and pages of W3L archive footage that I'm slowly putting in and converting into digital files. We've got Showdown, which we've been forced to, we wanted to keep that going. We didn't want to let COVID kind of break us and for everything to grind to a halt. So we've started delving into that archive and doing Showdown Rewind, which is giving people a chance to look back in time at how people started out and seeing some of these different wrestlers that we've had over the course of time.
I really enjoyed, because like I say, it showed one of the more recent ones was 5 weeks of my first W3L show, the first one I went to in the Elgin Town Hall. So it was really a cool way to go, my God, I can actually watch this whole show again and see it from a different angle, maybe see it from more experienced eyes now, because it's been 8 years.
Well, that's what we started off with. We started putting the whole shows up. But then, to be honest, I'll say why. There was two driving forces behind that. We were eliminating whole shows from our archive that could be used from other things. If you use the whole show, that show's out there now. It's on YouTube. But the other thing, I was finding it difficult to find full shows that didn't involve people that were involved in some of the negative things that we've had to face as a wrestling industry this year, because that's been there's been so many people connected to that, and we have to obviously figure out who's involved in what and how to move forward with all of that. And putting everybody on YouTube at the moment probably isn't the best of ideas. So that was kind of becoming a task. And also, you don't want to promote people. Sometimes don't want to promote people that are no longer actively working with you, and in some cases actively working against you. You don't necessarily want that on your YouTube channel, which kind of brings us to box office. We're trying to move with the times. I've always dragged my feet a little bit. If I could run the business off a CFAX page, I probably would. We've had the website for a number of years now, and I've somewhat got to grips with social media, so I thought we'd better jump on the on-demand bandwagon. And we've put all our DVDs up on w3lboxoffice.com. And there's some cracking ones up there. There's featuring all these big names that we're talking about. I think Clash of the Titans in particular, like pretty much every match features somebody that...
It's a DVD that I own. Again, I bought it at that show in 2012, so I have it. It's so many folk that are now NXT UK, WWE, like your Finn Balor. He's doing quite well for himself as NXT champion at time of record. So it's quite amazing. He's still, I don't know how, but he's somehow amazing, but somehow nowadays better. It's just, doesn't make sense, but yeah, there's quite a lot of names like your Killian Dane as well on that show.
My favourite line I remember from commentary is Alan Grogan, who was providing colour for that event, saying, "Look at Devitt. He's never had a Greggs in his life." As the camera showed Fergal's like chiselled abs. Never had a Greggs in his life.
Alan Grogan, it's been a while since I watched that show, admittedly, but I just remember Alan Grogan was just lying out. He was very Bobby Heenan on that show. He was just hitting every line out of the park. And not only that, you got to see some more familiar faces just working the crew as well. So it's really quite a nice little time capsule of future and of WWE stars and also...
You've got Jayla Dark in a sort of toga type thing up at the entrance set. Yeah, I thought at first that we could have done that as an annual thing and just had a different theme every year. So like the next year could have been Under the Sea, and we were all like we had them dressed as mermaids and stuff. But no, it didn't catch on. We left it as one. Maybe a medieval theme could have worked. We could have had some fun with that. But yeah, there's all these big DVDs that are out there. They're now on w3lboxoffice.com. And we're going to be releasing, we did a poll quite a while ago, and there's been a big delay in us finishing up with this because we were waiting to launch Box Office. We wanted to tie it in. So as of, I don't know when this is going to be coming out, but we're recording on what day of the week is this? Tuesday. And on Wednesday night, so it's probably already there by the time this interview airs, on Wednesday night on the W3L network, we are going to have the best of so W3L DVD highlights fans' choice, the first week of it. And this was voted for on W3L social media, and it will be from the Clash of the Titans, the first one. So it gives people a taste of what our DVDs look like. This isn't showdown. This isn't from one angle. We do that many shows, we can't film them all from two angles when we're not getting a sort of revenue in return from it. So without a television revenue or a need for people that want to buy all these DVDs, we can't edit everything together in two fancy angles. And that's why showdown's a one camera shoot. But on the Box Office channel, that's where we're going to have our content, where we have got better production. We've got the two camera angles linked in, we've got replays, that kind of thing. And it's a more sort of full presentation, and you'll be able to watch a match for free as voted for by the fans for free on the W3L network starting this Wednesday with one from Clash of the Titans, and every Wednesday moving forward. I think there was 5 or 6 polls that have gone up, so there'll be a good bit of content going on YouTube, w3lnetwork.com for that channel. And if you like what you see, you can go to w3lboxoffice.com and buy the full DVD on digital download. Obviously, you've still got the option of being old school like me. I like things in the case. I like my CD albums. I like to buy them and see them there. You can go to w3lwrestling.com and still buy the DVDs. And they come with like extras and stuff that you don't get on the digital downloads as well. So there's still a cause there for DVDs. We're not abandoning that.
I definitely, I mean, I don't buy them as often as I possibly should, but yeah, I like having DVDs. I like organizing them and all that kind of nerdy stuff.
You can touch it, put it on the shelf.
Exactly. Eventually
get it signed, maybe.
If this continues, I'm gonna have to possibly start making this look like an actual studio. At the moment it's just my den. I've got laundry over there, and I'm gonna have to like DVDs up in the background. I have to pick and choose which ones can go up, of course, because I've got some that definitely can go up. Of wrestling, I should really stipulate that.
Wrestling talk more DVDs about this, Billy. What are these DVDs?
We may have to talk about after recording, but yeah, there's some that just can't go up behind me in a shelf anyway. So it's definitely. I don't think DVDs will like totally go away, because there will be still people there, old school, and there'll be kids going, oh, I want to get that. DVD and all that. So back to ones you couldn't actually put onto the network. This is kind of not kind of an FU, but it's like, oh, if you're gonna have to, if we have to put a match out with someone that shouldn't actually have out there, it's like at least you're getting the benefit of it, kind of thing. You know what I mean? It's like if someone who maybe is actively working against you, let's say, it's like at least you're getting paid for them to be on.
You're not advertising them either.
That's what I mean. That's a much better way to put it. So you can at least put it out there, but you don't have to go, oh, you're going to see so-and-so.
Things like, you'll notice like DVD covers and as well. I just wish everybody got along and there wasn't these sort of kind of backstabbing incidents and disagreements and whatnot, but that's unfortunately it's just not the case. So yeah, we have to pick and choose which matches we put on YouTube. Sorry, my chair's awfully squeaky. I think it needs some WD-40.
I can't hear it, so it's fine. Well, I can't anyway. I don't know if anyone else can.
But yeah, you like DVD covers and stuff. You don't want somebody that's trying to take money out of your pocket on the front of your DVD and advertising their face. It just doesn't make sense.
It's the fun side of professional wrestling, not just Scottish wrestling, but wrestling in general is the politic bit of it, isn't it?
Oh yeah, yeah. Sigh. On the subject of DVDs, by the end of in conjunction with the DVD highlights fans' choice show every week, we're also going to be releasing a new DVD for Box Office. So by the end of the next 6 weeks, 2 months, our DVD catalogue for recent events will be bang up to date. We fell horrifically behind to the point that there was no light at the end of the tunnel for us catching up on editing these together and getting them produced and getting them out. So whilst the lockdown and the COVID-related restrictions have been horrific and just stopped us being on the road, stopped us training, stopped us doing what we want, what we love to do and what the fans love to see us doing, it's also given us a chance to catch up with a lot of things. And not only have we launched Box Office, but we now have 5 new titles that have been edited. They're ready, everything's done, and they're going to be drip-fed onto the Box Office channel over the next few weeks, which will bring our Box Office channel completely up to date. And we then, of course, have got a 17-year archive, many of which have got potential 2-camera edits that we can add on as sort of classic collection features in the future. But we're definitely going to be bang up to date within the next few weeks with our video catalogue.
Right, so it'll be things like your seven deadly sins, your resolutions, your bigger shows, certainly.
The ones that weren't, if they were on, there came a point where I made the call, like, we can't just keep filming everything with two angles and putting it in this queue. So that's when our events started going on the YouTube W3L Network channel. But Resolution didn't go up. Or at least I think maybe one of them did. So those events that didn't go up are because we filmed them with two angles, and we were gonna release them on DVD. So if there's stuff missing that's not on the W3L Network, it will be available on box office soon.
Excellent. So unfortunately, due to the situation at the moment, there is no light at the end of the tunnel for shows restarting. I know that your most recent tours, the ones that were supposed to be middle of the year, have been rescheduled. I suppose it's not, I mean, of course it's revenue and getting money into W3L and what have you, but at least you don't have to stop start storylines, because you've got that Wrestling Showdown's kind of condensed story within the show kind of thing, but it's just a case of actually returning. So,
and we had some exciting stuff planned for the events that were going to take place in April and May, and hopefully we'll be able to pick that up again soon. It's just a matter of waiting until the government say it's safe for indoor events. That might happen down in England before it happens up in Scotland. But even then, we've got to take things into account, like, is it, if they do open up, the one option is we may start back down in England before Scotland, if that's the way it works out. But that's only if it makes financial sense for us to do that, because we don't have as many venues down there, and we would have to then start all our outgoings in terms of, you know, we're currently not paying bills for things like public liability insurance for events that aren't happening. But once that starts again, that payment starts. So we have to be ready to go with enough events to justify us dusting off the kind of mothball that we've turned ourselves into to survive this, and getting back on the road. So as soon as they say it's safe to do so, and as soon as it's financially feasible for everything to kick back off again, it will. And in the meantime, we will keep rescheduling the events that our fans have held onto their tickets for, so that they know when provisionally those events will take place.
At least in that 17 years that you've been touring, you have went down south. So at least, like I say, when it is safe and what have you, you do have like the Ousburn and Newcastle. And other places, you do have venues that you go regularly to. So it's not like the wrestling's starting again, we're just going to pile into this town, and at least you've got kind of like a history with it. I have taken up so much of your time this evening, so we're going to kind of wrap up. So we've got W3LBoxOffice.com, we've got W3LNetwork.com. We also put the Wrestling Showdown matches on the SWN website each week.
It's very much appreciated. Thank you.
A couple hits in there. Also, there's some classic matches that I've been able to witness. I always get excited when I see that it's an Elgin one, because usually I see the back of my head, because I usually go the side where the camera is.
We've wound the clock right back now. I think it'll be a while until you'll get Elgin again on Rewind, because we ended up going right back to 06.
So yeah, we well for East Elgin, but yeah, there's still a humongous back catalogue already on the W3L Network. Just from yourself personally, just because we spoke so much about W3L, I had my lines here. I've got who'd be your wrestling heroes?
Oh, I like that you've put heroes. Because it's always a difficult one when it's just one. I was largely influenced by Shawn Michaels growing up. There's just something about everything that he did. And watching his matches now, I do think he's probably the greatest all-round performer of all time. I was also very influenced by Jake Roberts, spending time with him, and he has personally influenced a lot of the way I think and process wrestling. So those two certainly, yeah, I'd say those two. There's a short list of others as well that I admire and look up to, but those two spring to mind.
And other ones would be, if you had your pick of opponents, who would be your dream opponent?
Dream opponent. I would have loved to have worked with Jake, to have had a chance to actually have a match with him.
Excellent. So yeah, I think that's everything. So again, before we go, plug your social media, plug Action Arcade, just everything. Where can people find W3L and yourself?
W3LWrestling.com is kind of like our hub for everything, the social media and all that good stuff sort of links off there. And we're W3LWrestling on Facebook, W3LWrestling on Twitter, W3LWrestling on Instagram. And then we've got our two video platforms. We have got W3LNetwork.com, which links to our free YouTube channel. And we have the brand new and shiny W3LBoxOffice.com, which is our video on demand service where you can purchase DVDs and other exciting stuff that we have in the pipeline coming up.
Excellent. And where can we find you?
Oh, when I venture out on social media, I go through spurts. I've always thought I should do more on social media, and I do it for a while, and then I'll say something that causes problems, so I'll hide again if I can't be bothered with the stress. At Mike Musso W3L on Twitter. I don't have like a fan page, but I'm Mike Musso on Facebook, and I'll usually accept you on there. If I don't, it's probably because I've mistaken you from one of those sort of bot accounts, you know, where you click on it and they're like WhatsApp sex group and stuff like that.
Yeah, I didn't think that's where you're going to go with that, but yeah, I was going to be like just a creepy person, but no, yeah,
if you, there's creepy people as well, like you'll only get so many, like if you're weird, I might take you off it. But my Facebook's public anyway, so even if I take you off it, you can still see liberal use of the block button at times. But yeah, find me on there and I'll probably accept you or identify you as a Russian bot and not in that case. Do I have anything else? I think that's it. I've got Instagram as well.
No Snapchat. I don't know what else people have. I have Twitter, I have Instagram and Facebook. That's it. I don't need anything
one
else.
One of those Snap Talk things.
The Bebo.
I had a Bebo. Those were the days. Social media was simple.
Exactly. You just had to get your three loves a day, and you put your top 16 friends in order of who's not annoyed you that particular day.
Or for some people, who can benefit you the most at any particular time.
As of recording, just to pull back the curtain a little bit, we are recording it Tuesday, but it's like 10 to 11 in the evening, so I think we both need to go to sleep. I certainly do anyway. But yeah, thank you very much for agreeing to be on, and hopefully everyone will be heading to box office before this goes out, but this will be a little bit of incentive for anyone who's on the fence at all.
Yeah, get yourselves on that box office channel, get some DVDs consumed.
Perfect.
Thanks for having us, Billy.
No bother.